What's going on, guys? Risa back with another video, and in today's video I want to cover every winner from the FNCS trios. We don't know exactly what next season's going to be. Solos, duos, trios, squads, team rumble. We'll leave that one in there. So I'm basically going to try and give you this information in a way that you can apply it to any game mode, because we don't know what it is yet. Also, duo DreamHack will probably have already happened by the time I've uploaded this, but I'm just going to go in the presumption that there'll be more duo DreamHacks, so I'm going to be talking a little bit more about duos as well. So let's get into it. So let's start by looking at some similarities across all of the seven regions. And I'm also going to try and relate this back to the solo FNCS that I did previously, because I've got a ton of data left over from that and similarities between the regions, so it'll be good to compare these two. So every single winner of every region dropped uncontested. No matter where it was, they were uncontested for the majority of their games. On EU, obviously Mongrel, Mitro and Tayson were contested later on by Flick, Thomas HD and Anas. However, I'm still going to consider this uncontested, as they were uncontested for the majority of the time. On 6 of the 7 regions, all players also dropped in a POI and not on some scavenger looting path. The only exception to this was NA East, where Day, Miro and Reverse landed at 4 Crumpet, Fancy View House and the Hotel, which also is reflected on the solo FNCS as 13 out of the 14 winners there landed at a POI as well. This clearly shows that these teams are alphying up drop spots that are in a POI, and it's much more efficient to do this and not fight in the POI than it is to do anything else right now. And that seems to be consistent for any game mode. This obviously doesn't mean that you can't land at a scavenger looting path, but chances are it's not going to be as effective for a finals or grand finals. So maybe this is something to consider for the next FNCS, be it solo, duo, trios, or squads, or team rumble. For trios, only 2 of 7 winners dropped at a mythic POI, be that Stark Industries or Doom's Domain, in comparison to solos where it was 7 out of the 14. So last season for solos, mythic spots were way better. There's a couple of reasons for this. Obviously, firstly, the mythics this season just aren't as good. We don't have the mythic grappler, we don't have Kit's Shockwave Launcher, and it's not a solo meta, it's trios. However, this season, it really was not worth it for most teams. The reason for this is because of a highly sought after spot, which made it very contested in a lot of regions. And if it was contested, that kind of goes against what I just said about uncontested POIs being better. Therefore, it just was not worth going there. However, the teams who managed to get it uncontested were doing very, very well. In the earlier games of Mongrel, Mitro and Tayson, for example, landing at Stark Industries, they completely dominated. And the same thing happened on NA West, where Arkram, Rex and Epic Whale got Doom's Domain completely uncontested, and they were the most dominant trio of any region by far. So this season, the 2 mythic drop spots were not worth it unless you were completely uncontested. If you didn't manage to get them uncontested, it really wasn't worth it, and the people who were winning were not coming from contested mythic POI spots. You're much better off just trying to get a normal POI to yourself, get a good looting path so you don't have to fight in every early game, and be as consistent as possible for as many games as possible. Remember, we're talking about finals and grand finals here. This doesn't necessarily apply to opens and semis as much, because it becomes much more important to get higher eliminations in these in comparison to the finals and grand finals. The average looting paths of these trios was somewhere between 25 chests all the way up to 40 chests at the highest. And these kind of includes if they're landing at the vault and there's henchmen chests there too, so I'm including that within this number. What can you really extrapolate about this? Well, you can kind of take some baselines for when you're planning your own drop spots, again, regardless of the meta. So we can look at this the first way. So essentially each player needs roughly between 8 to 13 chests each on their drop spot. Now the less people on your team, so for example solos, you're going to need a little bit more chests because you don't have to share the other loot with other people. You can't get minis from your teammates when you're playing solos. So while planning a looting path, this is maybe something you should kind of look into. Is there roughly 8 to 13 chests per person in your team? And again, this is something that should apply to any game mode. So let's look into Storm Surge and how players went about getting their Storm Surge tanks, because in a Grand Finals environment, this is actually probably one of the most difficult elements of the game by far. Now, I in the past and a lot of people have definitely talked about Storm Surge a little bit too simply, but in all honesty, the crucial factor is that you know where the teams around you are and where they're going to rotate depending on each zone. And that's what the majority of these winning teams have done very well. So let's take an example here where the zone is in the southwest of the map and you drop at Craggy Cliffs. If you pop the rift and land on this hill here right on Stark Island, you'd think this is a high ground position near the edge of zone. There's going to be a ton of people rotating through here, so this will be some easy Storm Surge tanks. However, look at who might rotate through here. Firstly, the Kraken team who's already rotated, as that's you. The team who's landed in Heart Lake, who may have either already rotated through here at this point, or will have gone north to try and tag the people in Craggy and rotated through a dead side on the north side of the zone. The Stark team isn't going to rotate through here because they're probably going to rift or use the cars to rotate south towards the zone. And the team at Steamy almost definitely won't rotate through this way either, because they're going to go an edge map or down the south of the Stark Island. So you're on this nice high ground position, but no one is actually going to rotate through here for you to actually be able to tag these players. Do you need to pick a strategy for this specific zone, for this example, where you would actually be able to get tags, such as using a car or that rift to get you to the closer to the center of the zone, getting up on a hill and still being able to get your Storm Surge tags this way, because you're going to be closer to the center and more teams will be rotating around you. Now, the teams that we saw already in the FNCS trios were either doing this, or they were doing a strategy that I discussed in my last video with Sweaty Sands, where they're going to the dead side of the zone and trying to fight people this way. This worked because they knew the rotation, and based on the zone that these guys were still going to be in this POI, because they had great map awareness and awareness of the POIs around their drop spot, not just their drop spot. This meant they could go in, pick up Storm Surge tags, maybe even a couple eliminations along the way. Obviously, if it's a really strong team that's landing there, this probably is not the right choice for you, because you're going to get clapped by this team, no doubt. If Mongrel, Mitro, and Tayson were here, I would not be rotating through them to try and fight these guys. So last season in the FNCS solos, the majority of players were saving their mobility for the first moving zone, which is actually really different in trios. In the trio grand finals, the majority of players were using their mobility either to get to 4th and 5th zone, or in order to take height during the moving zones. A lot of players weren't really actually using their mobility to make them rotate further through the moving zones, which is the complete opposite of what we saw from the solo grand finals, because this is when all of the players want to use their mobility in the first moving zones. But this is mainly the difference between solos and trios. The reason for this is that when you use a shockwave or a crash pad in the first moving zone, your teammates get split so much, and you often end up playing by solo and going down because you landed in a really bad position, not with your teammates. So players are basically using their shockwaves, bounce pads, and crash pads to get into the 3rd, 4th, and 5th zones, then starting to rotate by foot. Then during the moving zones, they would split a shockwave between each player, triple shockwave up in their separate boxes, take height, and win the game from then on. Even trying to save some more shockwaves for the end game so they could throw them down onto players at the end, trying to heal off and push them into zone. So it actually differed quite a lot from the solo FNCS in terms of when people use their mobility. And on average, the teams who focused more on height, such as EU and Middle East, got more victory royales, but actually ended up having worse average placement. So on average, the teams who were playing low and mid-ground definitely were being way more consistent in getting to those end games, getting to that top 5 and getting consistent placement points, but were not as consistent in getting those victory royales. Now, this shouldn't really surprise many people, because going for height is risky, and if you overcommit to it and don't get it, you're going to waste a lot of your materials that are going to really reduce your longevity in this particular game. So taking height successfully is a risky play, but it does lead to more victory royales. However, playing lower low and mid ground is definitely going to give you way more opportunities to get consistent placement. The team who did it best was Arkham Rex and Epic Whale, as these guys managed to play height and low ground both extremely efficiently. They took height when there was an opportunity to do it, but didn't really ever overcommit to it. And when they didn't have it, they just played that low and mid ground as they do extremely well, picking up consistent placement and 2 victory royales. So let's start breaking down some of the individual regions and find some of the key strategies that these guys employed that stuck out to me the most. Our first region up is Middle East, and our winners here were Dexafite, i4x Pro, and Vagnar. These guys dropped at Catty Corner and also in the mountains near the weather station and up to the camp to the far right of that. They basically controlled this whole southeast corner, so the first zone rotates were relatively easy, as the only teams that needed to rotate near them were the guys at Lazy, the retail team, and also the guys at Camp Cod. In game 1, they had a fantastic first zone rotate, completely avoiding all teams and getting to a really nice position despite the fact that it was a max distance northwest zone. The zone was basically the same in the next game, however they made a slight deviation to this and ended up going down early because they bumped into another team. This small difference in the rotation ended up throwing the entire game for them, because they ended up having to take this unnecessary mid-game fight. The fact that their first rotate was so great, obviously they should have kept going to this exact same path that they took before, going through Lazy and then taking the water all the way down. However, they weren't aware enough of the other teams around them and took a slight wrong path into the team from Lazy Lake, and it didn't end up going so well for them. These guys took height very early, as I've talked about in a ton of my videos already, where they took height at 5th zone and had a large horizontal split trying to cover as much area as possible, as this reduces the opportunity for other teams to take height from you. Because they dropped a Catty Corner, they actually had peppers in their inventory, so they managed to use these in the endgame to consistently get them ahead further. This gave them more time to shoot, as they were building for less amount of time, and it was able to keep them consistently ahead of the zone, which gave them more angles to spray down on players below. These guys are masters of playing high ground, And in the earlier zones, they split front to back and vertically, just as always, but in the later zones, they start to split more horizontally as well, having one person on the far right-hand side of the zone and one person on the far left-hand side of the zone, with the final one way up above. You can see in this exact clip here why that's so beneficial. When the player shockwaves out, the player on height gets an easy beam on them, picking up the victory royale. Next up is the OCE region, and our winners there were Jinx, Alec, and Worthy. And if you know anything about trios in the OCE region, you know these guys already. They are insane. They were the first of two teams winning that dropped at Sweaty Sands, and I already made a video on Sweaty Sands, so if you want to know about the early game and all the stuff about that and why I think it's such a good, go check out that video. And lots of me plugging my own content, but I've also reviewed Jinx twice already and also Worthy in a video as well, links on screen and down below. So I was looking at this team's Storm Surge strategy and it's pretty simple, they just have Worthy on their team. That's it, that's the whole Storm Surge strategy. Worthy is incredible at fighting and getting tags on players no matter where they go. They do position themselves well to get Storm Surge tags, being on dead side of zone looking to fight teams there. At the same time, Worthy hits every single snipe shot that he takes, so I'm not really surprised that these guys don't really struggle with Storm Surge that much. And any mid game fights that they do take, because these three are some of the best players on the region, they really don't struggle too much. So early mid game isn't something that these guys seem to struggle with too much, or if they do struggle with it, it definitely didn't look like it. Why am I saying this? Well, it's because everyone needs to be good at solos and be their own individual best player that they can be as well, not just rely on their good teamwork. Jinx is a three-time FNCS champion, Worthy is probably one of the best fighters, if not the best fighter on the region, and Alec is also one of the most consistent players in the entire region. Combine these three together and they are insane because they have great chemistry, but also because each of them are insane individually. Just because it's a team mode does not mean that you should not be working on your own individual skill as well. So as always, do your aim training, practice in Crave, and please, play some solo arena. In their endgame, as always, Jinx is just one of the best players in the world, if not just in his region, at layering himself and getting his teammates into a great position. Notice how he is always on a lair by himself, just creating a full tarp and getting head of zone all the way, giving his teammates the best opportunities to actually pick up frags and help out. Worthy is one of the best fighters in the region, like I've said many times. Putting him at the back of the tarp will just give you free materials because he's just going to pick up those elims. And having Alec in the middle to help out either Jinx if he needs it or Worthy is a fantastic combination. Every time Jinx sees someone on his lair, he ends up moving up or down respectively, just to ensure that he gets to a lair by himself, and this is one of the ways that he's consistently making endgame and getting to that top 5 finish, and getting to the top 2nd and 3rds and that victory royale where the points are most important. Because he's so good at spawning these lairs, he can always get his team as far as possible, and this is one of the main reasons why these guys are just so consistent. Our next region is Asia, and this was won by Ruri, Moffin, and Bob. These guys drop at an uncontested Dirty Dogs. The thing that stood out to me the most about these guys is their absolutely incredible spacing. And what I mean by that is in the endgame, these guys are always next to each other and always there to back each other up if they get into an issue. If someone falls into their box, all three teammates are there to be able to pick up the eliminations and help each other out. And this is exactly what you need in an endgame. This isn't particularly important when you're in a situation where there's a lot of enemy builds around, you don't have control of all of the walls, floors, cones, whatever it may be, and it's just very likely that someone may edit on you or fall into you. It's so important that all of your teammates are there to help each other out. In this particular game, you can see how close they all are, and they all fall into this box, and they manage to pick up so many eliminations because of it. Now, it's not only just because they can pick up eliminations this way, but it's also because they can help break through builds faster, so they get stuck in zone for less amount of time, meaning they don't waste as much white HP. It means they can chug splash quicker, again, meaning they can heal up their white HP quicker, and you can see Bob make this fantastic crash pad play when he sees there's too many builds in front of him and it's too congested, so he just throws a crash pad at his teammate that pushes them into the zone. Overall, this close spacing will really save this team out and should be something that all trios, duos, squads, whatever it is in a team mode should be implementing when they're in situations that are very, very difficult. If you're split in these kind of situations, the chances are one of your teammates is much more likely for them to get picked off and not be able to do anything in the endgame. So on EU, our winners there were Mongo, Mitro, and Tayson, and these guys landed at Stark Industries and were uncontested from games 1 to 6. In game 7, they got contested by Flick, Thomas HD, and Anas, who eventually ended up actually winning off spawn multiple times there, and Mongrel's team decided they want to change up their drops. So in the last few games, they ended up dropping at Sweaty Sands. Now, I've seen a lot of discussion on people saying this was griefing, and why did people think this is griefing? Well, Sweaty Sands was previously uncontested by the team who was currently in second, which was Andalex, Janus, and X-Squeeze. By Mongrel's team landing there and contesting them and drawing out the early game, that meant that Janus, X-Squeeze, and Andalex had worse loot throughout the games. This also meant that they were going to get less points. and essentially they were 30 points behind and needed a really big game to capture up, and Mongol Mitro and Tayson's team needed to have one game where they didn't perform at all and get really any points. The final game, game 12, was very, very tense, and it was such a great spectator experience because Mongol's team was contesting them off spawn, and there was this kind of long drawn out fight. Neither team wanted to really do anything, and it ended up that Mongol Mitro and Tayson's team went down before Andlex, Janus and Xqueeze went down. This meant that there was a clutch potential factor for Andlex, Janus and Xqueeze capture up and actually take over that first place slot. Now unfortunately the long drawn out early game made them go down early as well, and Xqueeze is left solo to clutch up, but unfortunately was not able to secure enough points as that long drawn out early and mid game just messed with their gameplay too much. So this strategy that Mongol Mitro and Tayson employed, people have considered this griefing, but in all honesty it was completely the right decision. If they continued to go into Stark and lost off spawn, this would have given Janus, Andlex and Xqueeze a bigger opportunity to get more points and potentially have caught up to them, so contesting them was definitely the right play. So outside of that, what are some of the characteristics of their gameplay that made them so successful? Obviously the uncontested Stark loot gave them a great advantage in terms of weapons, shields and rotations, but outside of the early game, how did they play out some of their games and what was their strategies? Well, this team was super focused on height, and this has always been Mongol Mitro's bread and butter. This is obviously a bit of a risky strategy because they got less average placement than some of the other first places in any region. However, they did get the most tied victory royales, having 3 victory royales the same as the Brazil region. We know these guys can also pop off low and mid ground, but their main focus is to getting high, and they often overcommit materials and usage of their mobility to do so, leaving them in a less than favourable position for the end game to play low and mid ground. But how do they take height so consistently? Because these guys are always on height. The main way that they take height is, funnily enough, just by consistently gathering enough information around high ground and trying to find a weakness in it. They're consistently looking through their cones, always thinking about how can we take height and is there an opportunity to take high ground here. These guys have shockwaves because of where they dropped, and they're consistently gathering that information over and over and over again, and as soon as they see a weakness in high ground, they take it. And you know these guys have some of the best ARM in the game, these guys have some of the best focusing as well. These guys are consistently able to pick up high eliminations in the endgame, in one of the qualifiers picking up 10 eliminations in the finals just from height by triple spraying on players from down below. Moving down to the Brazil region, our winners there were Kurtz, Frosty and Redley. These guys dropped at Sweaty Sands just like our OCE trio did. This victory makes Kurtz and Frosty 2x FNCS champions, and this is Redley's first championship. You might remember Frosty from my FNCS Invitational solo winners video, and you may remember Kurtz from the World Cup where he placed 27th in the solos. The trend with this team was all about splitting vertical height. Now in the first zone, these guys had a storm surge strategy that was fantastic. They rotated to the center of first zone near the hills at the Sentinel's graveyard, and didn't only just take one hill, they actually controlled 2 separate hills, giving them a ton of space and different opportunities to get a lot of storm surge tags. In moving zones, like I've already said, this is no different. These guys keep a split to ensure that it's much more difficult for any team just to shockwave up and take it from them. One of the things that was quite an upset on the Brazil region is the fact that King, Sion, and Rusty K actually didn't win the grand finals. If you followed along with this region at all, you'll know that in the qualifiers, this trio completely dominated all 3 weeks. However, did not actually manage to replicate this into the grand finals. This trio was a very, very high ground focused team, and they always took it in 5th zone. Now, what relevance does this have to Kurtz, Redley, and Frosty? Well, in multiple of the games, they actually managed to pick up an elimination on this team and wipe them out in the mid game. And because they know that this team was so focused on high ground and claiming it early, this actually left a gap so that Frosty, Kurtz, and Redley know that there's not going to be as many people fighting for the high ground and that they can maintain it much easier. They actually made a lot of what people could consider psycho plays to grab high ground early in the 5th zone and win games because they knew that the top team contesting them was already out. This isn't something that really applies to an opens or semis because this is never going to happen. However, in a grand finals, knowing the playstyles of the people around you and seeing when they get eliminated and what opportunities open up for you can be very important. The NA East region was won by the TNATRIO, as I like to call them, of Day, Miro, and Reverse. These guys have a really different playstyle from a lot of the other people who've won of the other regions because these guys just play low ground. But firstly, before we get into that, let's look at their first thing that really stuck out to me while watching them through the qualifiers, heats, and grand finals. These guys, what we'd say, did not have a home. These guys dropped in each qualifier, in the heats, and in the grand finals in completely different spots. They went from steamy stacks to dirty docks, then in the heat they went down to Fortilla, and then in grand finals they ended up dropping at the west side of the map at Fort Crumpet, Fancy View House, and the hotel. The fact that these guys can play so well in any level of finals, pretty much landing anywhere across the map, is extremely impressive and shows truly how good these guys' playstyle actually is. So when they get to endgame, these guys are not focused on height at all. These guys actually got zero victory royales and ended up only having, out of 12 games, two of these were worse than 8th place, which is incredibly consistent. This is kind of exactly what we talked about, where the guys before who were getting a lot of victory royales weren't being as consistent. This is the complete opposite of that. This team was actually so consistent that they didn't even need a victory royale to win the entire tournament. And what these guys did differently is that they played low ground every single endgame. These guys really focused on getting ahead of the zone consistently and just box fighting everyone that was around them when they needed to pick up refreshes, and always kept away from other players as much as possible, conserving their materials as well. This strategy is very consistent because there's not a huge risk involved with taking high ground. When you're trying to take high ground, there's a big fight that can happen, people can shockwave you out, and that just doesn't happen when you're playing low ground. These guys played it so well, always sticking to dead side, always managing to keep a great lair to themselves, and always giving themselves enough space to box fight between, that they didn't even need to get a victory royale to win the tournament. This low ground playstyle is key to their success, and something these guys have been doing very well through all the qualifiers, heats, and grand finals. And I gotta give a shout out to my boy Somebody's Gun, who made this tweet long before the FNCS started, saying a low ground team will win FNCS, and he was right on. So last but certainly not least is NA West, and this was won by Epic Whale, Rex, and Arkram. These guys had by far the most dominant victory of all the regions, with 310 points being 109 points above second place. They had the highest average eliminations of all of the regions at 8.5 average per game, and the best average placement being 4.3. Just look at the match history here, it's absolutely nuts. They landed at Doom's Domain and they were uncontested, which should surprise no one, because who in their right mind is going to contest these guys? I've covered Arkram a lot, in particular like one of the last videos I did, which covered a lot of his solo play from different seasons, and to be honest, a lot of the same themes occur in this trio, deadside rotates being by far the biggest of them. You can see in this example here how in the second zone they're totally north side of the zone using a car to rotate, which was a really critical part of their early and mid game rotations. They simply rotate all the way down to the southeast side of the map, the dead side here, and set up. This is something that we've seen Arkram do in any meta, but bringing that clearly into the trios meta has been very, very dominant and part of their incredible consistency. It wasn't only in the early and mid game that these guys were using dead side rotates to their advantage, as they were doing this in the late game too. When they play low ground, they're consistently staying right to the edge of the zone and staying as far ahead as possible, ensuring that they're keeping away from as many teams as possible. This means that they have to use less materials because they're only doing a floor above them, a floor below, and a wall to the side, and at the same time gives them plenty of opportunities to take shots and fight players that are behind them. They're not just a low ground team though. When they have high ground, these guys know how to play it exactly and are completely dominant. These guys have a great mix of being able to play high ground when there's an opportunity to do so, but they mainly focus on low ground. And this is what most teams' balance will probably be like. They should set themselves up in a reasonably high layer in the 4th and the 5th zone and take that high ground if it's possible, maintaining it through the moving zones. But if they can't do this, and if it's someone else is just going to overcommit to high ground, there's no need to waste your materials trying to fight these guys off, and it's best just to play your own game because you're going to save your own materials and your own heals. Something that really stands out to me about their endgame is just their situational awareness. So let's give a few small examples, and these things might seem very minor, but they're just little things that add up that show why this trio is so good. If you want to look over their dead side rotates and how they do that, my Arkram video covers all of that already. And what they did here was basically just the same, so I don't want to repeat it. So let's look at a couple minor things that they do instead. So in Asia, we talked about their spacing and how great that was and how close they were all together. Now, this is a team who does that exact same thing. While they're really scuffed and within dangerous areas, they space very, very close together. But notice this, when they get a full tarp and they have a lot of space between them, they also spread out much more. This is because they have a lot of space to work with, and this allows them to get much more angles to take shots on opponents. It also gives way more opportunities to get ahead of the zone, while Epic Whale and Rex kind of stay a little bit far behind and try to get these opportunities for eliminations. So their awareness of how good their lair is very, very key. When it's congested, these guys are really close. When they're safe, they spread out more. Here's a small little mechanical thing for those players who play low ground like this team does very, very frequently, and the same on NA East for the TNA team there. We're on this kind of awkward hill where they have to move up. Notice how Epic Will double ramps because there may be a player above him in the box, and then places a wall to the side and edits through this. This is a really safe way to get up a layer and make sure you don't get edited on from a player through the wall behind you. Also then, you can notice he comes into this area that's really, really unsafe. And this is one of the key factors and such a small thing. They're always looking ahead of them. You can see ahead of them there's a building that has a roof that you can't end up editing or building through. So they intentionally just do not go through that route, and they end up turning to the left and choosing a safer path. This is a very, very minor thing, but it's something we've seen this team do very, very consistently. It's just find the safest path all the time. And this is because they're a bit ahead of the zone, and it gives them enough time to actually be able to notice all of the things around them and where they're going to go. If this team was stuck behind deep into the zone, they'd really struggle with this because they have to just move faster to ensure they don't get caught in the zone. But because they're so far ahead, they can plan exactly which route they're going, where they're going to take, and the safest ways to do this. There has been a ton of work that's gone into this video. I hope you guys have enjoyed it. Please like the video if you haven't already liked the video. Please subscribe if you aren't already. Please consider using my creator code in the shop, which is just resub. Now that the broadcast is over, I have way more time, so I'm going to be putting out 3 videos every single week. And I hope you guys have a good day. Hope you guys learn a lot. Catch you later. Peace.